world over dying. So someone would rather die than give a speech in public. Like right now, I'm actually dying myself. So my heart's going a mile a minute. So we're actually going to go ahead and start introductions. So my name is Samantha. I go to CSUN, and I'm a comms major.
I'm Sam. I'm an English major.
I'm Larissa. I'm a communications major.
And I'm Kristen. I'm an English major.
So first off, we're going to start off by saying, why does public speaking matter? So in any interview, you want to be sure to sell yourself, you want to be confident in how you're speaking, and you want to make sure that you're giving your delivery as clear as possible. In a public setting, you want to be sure to express yourself clearly, make sure people know what you're talking about, make sure you know what you're talking about. And in a presentation, you want to be sure to get your point across as much as possible, and be sure that you know what you're talking about. And just gather your information properly, concisely, organized. And what we'll be focusing on today is the ways of delivery in a public speech.
All right. So first we're going to talk about nonverbal delivery. We'll get to verbal delivery later. So this includes stuff like eye contact, the way you're dressed, the way you're moving, the way your hands are moving. And first, we're going to get into eye contact, which is pretty important. So eye contact is pretty much one of the most key ways you connect with your audience. Eyes are very expressive. So what you don't want to do, first of all, is you don't want to stare at someone. You're staring at someone. How do you feel? How do you feel when I stare at you?
Awkward,
yeah. It's really awkward for both the presenter and for the person you're staring at. It's really creepy. Also, what you don't want to do is look around a lot like this, because then you look insane. You look like you don't know what you're doing. So what you do want to do is share the stare. So we'll look at you for a little bit, then I'll move on, then I'll move on, then I'll move on. You want to share the stare. So you don't want to creep anyone out. Also, you want to find friends. This is an alternative. If you don't want to share the stare very much, you can find friends, which are people in the audience that you want to look at, finish your point, then move on, look at them, finish your point. And you're looking at these same four people every time you move. And it looks like I'm looking at all of you, but I'm really not. I'm looking at what I call friends, which I have no idea who you are, so I'm sorry. Next, we're gonna talk about what you should wear. Oh, and Nick Cage is perhaps the master of the creepy stare. So have you ever seen the movie Vampire's Kiss? It's fantastic, it's been really great. You've seen it? It's amazing. Watch this movie if you wanna look at how not to interact with people. Okay, next is appearance. This depends on the situation. So you always want to dress for success, and again, that depends on the situation. If you're at an interview, you probably want to go business, which for dudes is a shirt, a jacket, some nice pants, some shoes. For ladies, it's a blazer, a blouse, a longer skirt, nice shoes. If you're in class, like we are right now and presenting, go for dudes, a shirt, some nice pants that aren't really terrible, some okay shoes, I guess. And then if you're at a toast, if you're at a buddy's wedding, or you're also just at like a party, you gotta give a toast to your friend. You probably are in casual if you're at a party, or if you're at a wedding, you're probably in a tux or a dress. So dress accordingly to whatever situation you're in or you're gonna speak.
So now that we've talked about eye contact and appearance, I'm going to be talking about facial expressions. And my name is Kristen, by the way, in case you forgot. So facial expressions, well, when you're presenting, you are on display. You are up in front of everyone. Like right now, I'm up in front of all you guys. All of you guys can see me. It's a little scary to think about, but facial expressions are very important because what you show here is just as important as what you're saying. So just be mindful of what you're doing at all times. And so certain facial expressions actually commute a lot of different things. So if I'm smiling, it's maybe I'm excited, or maybe if it's like a nervous smile, I'm nervous. Or if I'm like frowning, obviously I'm upset. Or if I'm like looking up, like I'm thinking. There's a lot of things that you get from facial expressions. So when you're considering your topic, you want to consider whether or not it's an intense topic or if it's lighthearted. If it's a little lighthearted, of course, you could be more friendly and project yourself more. Show your emotions. What you don't want to do is just stand up there, be like, I'm presenting today, blah, blah, blah. No one's going to listen to you. Like, you want to be, like, not animated, but just show, like, you are a real person and you have real things to say, and people should listen to you. But if you're just standing up there, like, whatever, no one's going to pay attention to you. So just take that under consideration. And now that we've talked about eye contact, appearance, and facial expressions, we're going to be talking about gestures. So I've been moving my hands around a lot. Like, I like moving my hands around. I'm kind of fidgety, but used to be a lot worse. I used to shake a lot. And one thing that I do is I like to feel my fingertips when I'm nervous. So I go like this and I just rub my fingertips together. And it's really weird. Does anyone have any like weird like nervous tics? I know all of you have it. Some people bite their nails. My brother bites his nails. They're like little stubs. So like when you're up there, obviously it's okay to be nervous, but just be mindful of what you're doing. And if you want to make gestures, make sure they have a purpose. Don't just like flail your body around like, yeah, this, listen to me. You want to be intentional. So you, I'm speaking to you, and then if I'm speaking to me, I'm talking about myself, because there's a lot of stuff you can do with your body that says more than your words can.
So going back to me, we're going to be talking about posture and the importance of posture. So this is just a little diagram here of how to properly stand up straight. Now, good posture consists of not leaning back so far, because that will hurt your back later on. You're going to be standing up in front of a group of people for a long time, plus your nerves will kick in, you're going to start shaking, you don't want to be uncomfortable. You don't want to slouch either, so you want to make sure that your neck is aligned with the rest of your spine and goes all the way down to your rear. And you want to make sure that your neck is up high, but you're not like holding your head way up. And a very good tactic for public speaking, actually, is a power pose. Now, who knows what this is? Thank you, Mr. Tucker. So for a power pose, it's actually something that is in a TED Talk. It's a really, really great TED Talk, especially for those who are getting introduced to public speaking. Power pose is basically you take up as much space in the room as possible, and it just lets you feel more powerful than you really are, realistically. And it allows you to take up the room, it allows you to feel more confident, build up that courage to give that speech that you've been dying to give. And I actually found this out my first year of college. I was at Moore Park doing a few units, and I took a psych class, and we watched that TED Talk. And before a presentation, I would actually go into the bathroom, and I would do power pose. Like, I would do this, or I would do that, or like have like just take up as much room as possible. And it really, really helped build my confidence. It really helped make sure that I felt good about myself before giving the speech, so that way it could ensure that I would feel good about what I was delivering. Oh, right, and you want to make sure not to lock your knees either.
Or you will die.
You will literally pass out, and it's just not fun. You want to make sure not to like completely bend your knees, but like give them a little wiggle here every now and again. And make sure that your feet are hip distance apart, just to keep yourself really grounded in where you're standing. That way you feel good, your feet aren't too close together, and they're not like spread out, but good, comfortable distance. And now we're gonna move on to verbal delivery. And speaking clearly is very, very important when it comes to verbal delivery. And this consists of enunciation and pronunciation. Now, I have a question for you guys. Has anyone in here seen Harry Potter? You know that movie where he's in the fireplace and he's like trying to go somewhere and he mispronounces the name? So that's why he was under the stairs for 10 years. He mispronounced the place where he's trying to go. And that's also really, really important when it comes to public speaking, are those two things. So enunciation, for those who don't know, is basically saying your syllables. So in grade school, you would clap to figure out your syllables. Same thing as enunciation. Articulation. So it really, really helps get your point across, especially if people know what you're talking about. And in addition to that, pronunciation is really, really important, because if you don't know what word you're trying to say, your point's not going to go across. You're not going to have any credibility to go off of. And a really good example of how to figure that out is Webster's Dictionary. They actually have in parentheses next to the word how to say the word and how to pronounce the word. So that's really, really helpful. And we're going to move on to vocal variety with Larissa.
Okay, so when you're delivering your speech, your voice is very important. It's a powerful form of expression that shows your audience how confident you are and how much control you have. So with practice, you will learn how to adjust your vocal delivery. So the elements of vocal delivery include volume, pitch, speaking rate, pauses, and vocal variety. So first of all, it's volume. So obviously, volume is how loud you're speaking, and it is the most obvious noticed element. So you want to make sure that the audience can hear you, but you also want to take some things in consideration. So depending on how big the classroom is or how big your audience is, it's how loud you want to speak. Also, whether you have a microphone or not, it depends on how loud you will speak and the level of background noise. And your pitch is range of sounds from high to low or vice versa. And this controls your speech through intonation, which is rising or falling of sound across phrases or sentences. And it is important because it powerfully affects the meaning. For example, if I say stop, it has like no meaning, but if I say stop, then it conveys the meaning, and you also don't want to sound monotone because it's very boring. And you can practice changing your voice by recording yourself, and when you record yourself, you notice if you sound monotone or you just practice how you sound. And your speaking rate is how fast or how slow you give your speech. So there's really no standard or ideal rate how you should give your speech, but you also want to take in consideration that you're not speaking too slow, because your audience will get bored and they'll fall asleep and they will not pay attention to you. And you don't want to speak too fast, because your audience will view you as unsure about your control, and if you're nervous and you talk too fast, it's just a really negative impact, because it just shows that you're trying to get it over with. And pauses are also very important, but as new speakers, it makes us uncomfortable because we don't really know how to feel confident when we're giving a speech. And pauses enhance meaning by providing a punctuation, emphasizing a point, drawing attention, or just giving the audience to contemplate what's being said. And pauses also serve as a way to avoid filler words such as like or so. And if you use too many filler words, you're also distracting your audience from the message that you want them to perceive. So pretty much what I went over was volume, pitch, speaking rate, and pauses, and all of these work together to create a vocal variety. And the key to effective vocal delivery is to vary these elements with the tone of enthusiasm, because if you don't sound enthusiasm, it's gonna be really hard for the audience to pay attention to you.
So now we're gonna go over the proper use of words. And one of them is knowing their meanings. For a really long time when I was a kid, I would actually use really big words to make myself sound smarter. And which sounds really stupid and ignorant, but it's what I did when I was a kid. So when I was a lot older, I would use the same word. And someone actually ended up correcting me with the usage of that word in that sentence that I was trying to use it in. And my face turned white. I felt like I was gonna pass out because someone was calling me out. And I didn't like that. So I ended up learning what the words mean before I actually use them. Just so that way it makes yourself more credible as a person and as a speaker especially. You wanna make sure that your audience believes what you say. You wanna make sure that you have credibility. Otherwise your word doesn't really mean anything.
Also, we're going to go over something that we don't know about anymore very much, is you guys, expressions. Do you guys have any expressions nowadays that you use? Like when I was in high school, something that went around which was utterly ridiculous was savage. That's savage. Yeah, see, that sound right there. Oh, that's savage. That's cool. So I just want to hear from you guys if you guys have any expressions
or
that you
slang,
use.
Or what
slang.
You use.
What? No.
Like what I've heard of now is like hundo peas or no one says that anymore.
When ship was a big thing, like oh I ship them or like you
I've never
so
even heard
so
that.
That was weird. I don't get it.
Yeah, keep saying these because we have no idea.
We have no idea.
Should.
It's been a while.
Explain them. What does that mean?
Ashley's answer is advice. Really? Like,
oh.
The fade is like.
We have no idea what they mean, and if you're worried that your audience will have no idea what they mean, you don't want to use them. So what was the one you said? Just for fighting?
Catch these hands.
Depending on your audience, you probably would not want to use that. Yeah. So with each other that might work, with older people it won't work. One that I'll talk about, because I've broken this rule, is no cussing. I did this in our class, and I went from an A to a B. Yeah. So, I know you want to do it, it's in your head, you know it can just come out, but please do not cuss. For your own sake, because you will lose marks. You'll go down a grade.
And then, Kristen, do you want to go over the example?
Oh, yeah. And so that example, I don't know if you guys watch New Girl, but basically this was an episode where Nick, the guy, and he said upmost. And while we might think, I thought that was the right way, like, oh, the upmost importance or whatever, is actually utmost. And he was just being really confused because he's like, what is an ut? That doesn't make any sense. But even though it sounds weird, that's really the word. So when you're saying things, just make sure you like double check yourself, because even things you might think that are right might not be right, because upmost sounds right to me, but it's utmost. So just keep that in mind when you're talking about certain things or you have certain words that you think you know, maybe they're slightly different. So just keep that in mind.
So in conclusion, we've gone over nonverbal delivery, which consists of eye contact, dressing for success, expressions, which also include gestures and posture as well. Verbal delivery, which is speaking clearly, the proper usage of words, and vocal variety. And now we just need 15 of you guys to stand up for us.
Wait, before we stand up. Stand up. There will be candy involved.
Yes.
Only one boy. Okay, two people stand up for candy.
Jesse, you gotta go.
Yeah. Come on, Jesse.
So,
okay, wait.
Hang on. You guys feel like...
We're on both columns.
So basically, we're going to be calling each of you guys up here. Not calling, but like whoever wants to volunteer. So you're going to be taking one of these words and make a one-sentence story out of it. And then you can popcorn someone who also volunteered and have them continue using another word from the board.
Have to be like 30 seconds.
Yeah.
This will take a while.
Yeah. Like 30 seconds to 1 minute.
Good thing
we're in like a story or anything like a sentence of something that happened in your life. And then the person who is after can either start a new one or continue that story. It's improv.
To an end, we are going to graduate, we're going to go on to college, and then we forget. Cameron?
Okay.
Oh, hey,
you can just start.
All right,
okay,
yeah, so we're
good
here.
You can just start.
The,
you can start.
Wait.
And like say it in there.
Oh yeah, you choose.
As the year comes to an end, we are filled with sadness that pineapples, you know.
Okay, no, you guys have to actually like, you know, like keep it going.
That pineapples.
Come make the sentence, but try to complete the sentence.
Pineapples don't belong in Chuck E. Cheese because John Tucker drove. Pineapples don't belong on pizza because no one likes them. Although pineapples may not belong on pizza, a Nissan GTR does belong in my garage.
Do I have to start with the Nissan or the...
No, you can just start over. You can pick a new word and then start.
Okay. Although a Nissan GTR does deserve to be in Gino's garage, I believe John Tucker deserves a Nissan GTR. Definitely. Would pick somebody?
Yeah.
Who are the people? Anybody?
Yeah.
Anybody volunteer?
Volunteer.
Ashley.
Okay.
I just remember her name.
Okay, I'm just gonna say something random.
Yeah.
This is how you say raccoon in sign language.
You have to pick somebody. Laura.
Who's
this? Laura. She volunteered.
She said, whoa,
Sergio volunteered.
Not only is a gorilla a very majestic animal, the Gorillas is also a really good band.
Nice.
The best part.
Go.
Brandon. grim ideas of what the future might hold, but we all know that it's really going to be something concerning sucking all the oxygen out of the atmosphere or poisoning the water supply.
She's Hawaiian, so I don't really know what happened right there, but that's it.
In the corner of my room and pretend I'm a kid. And I also like to skateboard sometimes.
Peers and mentors that
This is just like a public service announcement, but be careful who you get your open drinks from. Be anything, be alcohol, iced tea. Because, you know, there's lots of people in this world. You know, some might drug you like Bill Cosby, or some might try to slip you a little laxative. I've never seen a laxative in anyone's drink, so don't accuse me of anything, but I've seen what happens, and it's kind of not fun.
Nice.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Questions about what it's like, questions about how to get your classes, questions about etc. Michael, you don't get to go first. Gino, and then Michael, you can answer your question second. Go ahead, Gino.
Yes.
Do you, can you pick, like, if you want more uni in that class, or did they just give it to you based on what they have?
You can pick.
But as you were specifically a CSUN, there's priority.
Yeah.
So freshmen have top priority, they get to pick first. So you do get to choose when your classes are, but depending on your priority, they'll be full. So as a sophomore, we have,
horrible. Yes.
I had the worst pickings.
Mm-hmm.
So the lowest priority, so you can find opportunities that give you top priority. What's it called? Yeah, you can get priority, you can do like taking notes for kids that need it and get top priority, and then you get free range.
Yeah.
So you do get to pick, but priority.
But also too, some classes, like if they're really specific, only one professor might teach it, and they might only do it at a certain time. So if it's like a popular class, there might be more classes for that particular class, and they could probably range a lot more at times during the day, but there's others. Like I'm taking like two right now, where it was like, there was only two options. So I have a class that's like from 4 to 6:45. Even though I don't want to be on campus that late at night, like I have to because I had to take that class, but that's the only option I had, so.
Yeah, and another example of that, like my entire college career, I've only gone to school Tuesdays and Thursdays. You don't have to go Monday through Friday. There's not even, some classes aren't even there on Fridays. So it's mainly Monday through Thursday typically, but you can also choose to do 2 days out of the week. I would usually do Tuesdays and Thursdays or Mondays and Wednesdays only. But this is the first semester where I have to go to school Monday through Thursday, and I'm on campus all day until like 9 p.m. from like 2 to 9 p.m. So it really depends on your registration date.
Yeah, you can put classes on one day if you really want.
Yeah,
I would not recommend that at all. That's really bad.
You can do online classes, which is at your own pace, or there's even online campus. There's online classes on campus, which you have to sit in the classroom, but still do your stuff online during that time period. So it really just varies, but it's a lot more flexible. So yeah. Do you have one more hand or two more hands, I think?
It was already answered.
Oh, okay. Anything else you guys are curious about? Yes.
Do you ever take advantage of your professor's office hours?
No. But you should.
Yeah.
You really should.
Mr. Tucker, can I come in and take your
name? No. So what are office hours, and why do you say you should take advantage of them?
Office hours are basically your professor's private time. Like, it's their time away from class, which may seem like you're invading that space, but they're there for you to ask questions. Say, like, you get a bad exam grade or you get a bad score on your paper. You have that opportunity to go up to them privately in, like, a nice, safe space and ask them why, or ask them what you can do for better, like, a better score. Our professor, actually, she requires you to go to her office hours at least once, just so she can get to know you.
Or at least it's in her other classes. Sorry, I don't want to scare you. I don't want to scare you.
I should
take
advantage of my professor's office.
You should take advantage. I personally, I like getting to know my professors. I like talking to them and picking their brain as well, so that way I can grow a better relationship with them. Not to ensure you a better grade, but that way maybe you can do better in the class if you like your professors. That's also a good thing about college, is you can choose your teachers. So it's really great to know your professors. You build a relationship with them, you know, like you kind of have this unspoken understanding about each other. So it is important to take advantage of your professors.
I personally go to office hours because it really does help you a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when you're writing your essay, you want to go and make sure that you're doing one.
It also helps with networking. So if you know what your major is, and if you can get to know a professor really well, they can introduce you to other professors and other people. So just getting a network together is a big part of why you're in college, and office hours really help with that.
And internships too, they can really help with networking with internships if you have connections. With that, it's so important for you to have connections. So
anything else?
Mm-hmm.
What's something you shouldn't do in college?
Don't skip class. Even if you show up, and it's way better than just staying home. Because you just listen, and even if you listen, you can remember stuff that's going to be on the test.
Mm-hmm. And like, if you think about it, like if you're missing a class, like you're throwing money away. Mm-hmm. Like you're paying tuition, it's coming out of your pocket or financial aid, but still it's money that's being used for you to go. And if you don't go, it's like, just think about it, like you're throwing $100
There's
away like every single day.
Plus, on top of that, if you miss a certain amount of classes, the professor has the right to drop you from the course, which causes you to lose more money, plus take it again the following semester.
And most professors, some won't care if you're not there,
mm-hmm.
so you have to take it upon yourself to make sure that you're there, because they will just leave you behind.
Mm-hmm.
That's what happens.
And they won't care if you go to their office hours and are like, okay, I haven't been to the past 3 classes, what's been going on? It's up to you. It's your responsibility to figure out what's going on, because that way you're accountable of your grade. They won't fix your grade. They won't give you extra credit or have you make up assignments.
Late work
mm-hmm.
does not exist in college.
At all. Ever.
Anything else?
Another question?
Yeah.
Do you do presentations on college, or does it depend on your major?
I'd say you do a lot of presentations, like just in general.
Yeah, not in math.
Yeah,
probably.
Actually, I have one in math.
No way.
Yeah.
Wow.
Math ideas.
Yeah.
It depends on your major too. Like she's a comms major, so she's probably speaking more than I do.
I have 4 presentations this semester, plus research papers and finals to do as well. So you're going to be constantly making speeches, and maybe you're not going to be a communications major. A requirement for you to either transfer or graduate is a public speaking class. So you just have to keep that in mind. Well, you're going to be speaking, you're going to be doing presentations in all your classes. So, anything else? Yeah.
All right. So, what is like a manageable like school life work balance for you guys? Like how much are you able to like hang out with your friends and make unseemly choices? How many hours a week are you able to work and still be a full-time student and feel like you're giving the necessary amount of attention to your studies?
I'd say about 20 hours of work, 15 to 20. I work part-time at Macy's and I go to school full-time. I'm taking 16 units this semester, so I am a full-time student. I work part-time and I have a social life. I try to maintain a social life. There are some weekends where I don't go out because I am so swamped with homework. But there are also some weekends where I go crazy and I'm like, okay, it's the weekend. Might as well treat myself before I can go back to hell on Monday. So it really just depends on your pace as far as how quickly you want to graduate too. So.
Yeah, it really depends on what classes, or when you pick your classes.
Your schedule.
Yeah, how many you pick, because you can, I don't know the math, but you can...
17, depending.
Now you can have like 6 classes at once, which is a lot. I don't know how many classes you guys... I know I took 8 classes in high school, but in college, 6 classes is
a
really
lot.
So it also depends on your opportunity. If you guys can stay at home with your parents, then hopefully have rent taken care of. don't have to worry about that, unless they make you pay rent, which some do.
Mm-hmm. So me personally, I work around 20 to 25. Last week I worked 29 hours and I'm a full-time student. So I basically just work Thursday to Sunday, and I only work like 8-hour shifts, and then I take care of all my school work Monday to Wednesday, and sometimes Saturday. So that's how I manage my schedule.
And I myself